Good. Okay, today's Tuesday, January 20th, and this is Chris Payton, and I'm here with Robert Rush, and we're checking to see if the recorder works. Okay, I think we're live again here. We're starting every interview that we do, with asking people how they came to meet Johnny Mercer, and when, approximately when.
I met him at a furniture store, actually a hard surface store that sold tile and carpeting on Lido Isle. And he and Ginger had just bought the house on Lido Island and were going to do it. And he said that they wanted to use somebody locally instead of somebody from the city. And would I be interested in doing the house? So I went over and I guess never left.
So you worked on the Lido house?
Yeah, I worked on the Lido house, and then Johnny, for a while, had a suspension with his driver's license, so I'd drive him to town. And then they took an apartment in town, and took a little townhouse, and I did that for them, or, you know, helped decorate it. And then, I was taking care of the kids, and I was, you know, taking Mrs. Mercer places and that sort of thing, so it became a friendship as long and as well as a work sort of thing with me.
So you did all kinds of things.
I did all sorts of things.
It's a wonderful way to get to know people.
Oh yeah, well I mean it was family, literally.
Why was his license suspended?
He'd had a couple of drinks and he ran into somebody coming off the freeway. On the off-ramp, he rear-ended them.
Oh,
and they came out, and so it was suspended for 6 months, which meant somebody had to drive him every place.
Right.
You know.
And we'd heard somebody else had told us that the trip from where the house was up to Los Angeles for business stuff was really a drain, and that's one of the reasons they took the townhouse, the apartment?
Yeah.
Was that, to make it easier?
They took it on 6th Street, right over here, 6th near Fairfax, at the Prudential building. And had a lot of parties there. I remember Julie London came and sang and sat on the staircase and had to be mic'd. Her voice was so small. But then Johnny went out golfing one day and there was a for sale sign at a house in Bel Air right there on the 13th hole. And he called me up and he said, I've got a surprise for Ginger for Christmas. And we're going to do the house and have it for a surprise. And I said, you're going to have it as a surprise. Because I'm not doing anything for your wife without her knowing about it. So he said, okay, well, we'll tell her about it. And then we started, as everybody does, redoing a house. Couldn't live in the thing the way it was. It had to be all redone. So we took the third bedroom and made it into a dressing room for Ginger for clothing and purses and shoes and stuff. And put a safe in. And then turned the garage into a studio for Johnny because he suddenly found that he didn't really need to go to the studios. That he could do his work right there and then take it in. So he would leave in the morning and walk across a, you know, 50 feet of asphalt. And then come over for lunch, go back and work, or play golf or whatever it was, and then have dinner. So he was 50 feet from his house.
Wonderful way to work if you can work
it. Yeah, well, it was a great way to work. It was. But at the Lido house, I remember I did a plaid in his bedroom, and he said it was a beige background with yellow, green, and blue. In it. And he said, take the blue out of it and use it for the wall covering. So one time I was driving him back from Los Angeles and he said, I don't know why, but I always get so depressed when I go down to the Lido house. And I said, I'll fix it for you this week. What are you going to do? And I said, I'll tell you when you'll see it. So instead of the blue, I took out the yellow and had the walls painted over in yellow. And he came back and he said, I wake up each morning and whether the sun's shining or not, it is in my bedroom. And that was all the difference in the world. It was the color change. Mm-hmm. And that's all that it needed to lift his spirits.
So he was pretty much aware of
the things
that around him.
Completely.
And the atmosphere around him.
Oh, God. One time, he was in New York doing Saratoga. And we wanted to redo the living room. And in those days, you did the draperies and the furniture, and the furniture was quilted, and you'd pick out a pattern, and everything was done in it. So he picked out this pattern and sent it off to New York, and he sent it back 2 months later, which one he figured he liked. By that time, they discontinued the fabric. But the colorway they had, and instead of tulips, it had daisies. So Ginger said, he's never going to know the difference, and go ahead and use it. So I went ahead and did the living room. And he came home and he walked in, looked at it, turned around to me and he said, you know, I like the daisies better than the tulips. So, I mean, and it had been months since that fabric had been in his hands. Mm-hmm. But he knew exactly what it was. The color ways were exactly the same, but it was just different flowers. He was funny about it.
And that was the Bel Air House?
No, that was the Lido House. Then they bought the Bel Air House, and the kitchen had to be redone in the floors. And as I said, one of the bedrooms made into a dressing room for Ginger and storage. And then Jeff had his room upstairs, and Johnny always had his own bedroom because they would sleep and wake up at all different hours all night long. And if they were in the same room, it drove each other crazy. So he was clear at the other end of the house. And after he left us, Ginger wouldn't go near the thing.
Really?
Oh, yeah, because she could feel his presence. It was very strange with Johnny, because I had the same experience with Clifton Webb and his mother, Maybelle. And I'd go out to the house and sit across the street, and you can hear him talking. I mean, literally.
After he passed.
And Johnny was the same way. I could go into that bedroom of his by myself. Which, I mean, there was, you know, they're always friendly. But I'd go into that bedroom and I knew he was there. Because there was something so innately spiritual about the man that never was spoken, never was said. But you had an affinity, just a liking and a loving for certain things of the same, and he just never leaves, you know. I knew him all those years and he still hasn't gone. Thank goodness.
What were some of the things that you had an affinity, that he had an affinity for?
Oh, one time he said to me, you know, I've had the opportunity to go with all sorts of different women when I've been doing movies. And he said, do you think I'm making a mistake by just sticking with Ginger? And I said, you have to live with yourself. And he said, yeah, you're right. But there was a thing. He had great respect for his parents and for his brother Walter. He had a great family thing. And he loved his kids too much. You know? Mandy will tell you that, I mean, they were so spoiled with anything and everything that they wanted because he wanted them to be happy. And he didn't know that his being there was the happiest part of the whole thing. And so he'd buy them just anything that they wanted. And their friends, they always had a lot of friends. But he never went any place that he didn't bring me something, you know. Or Christmas would come up and it would be something that I'd seen during the year that I'd mentioned to him, you know, in passing. Not a thought in my head about it. And there it would be. They both were that way. Mm-hmm. But,
Mandy's son told us that he had a boyish streak that stayed constant throughout.
Oh, I mean, it's a thing of never growing up.
Well, he told us, Jim did a story about J- Johnny took him out, and they bought those submarines that had the pellets.
Right.
My brother had these, where you sink them,
yep,
and then the pellets bubble, and they come up. And the Bellar House didn't have a pool, so they went to the property next door that did. And they sank them. And they went down, and I think Johnny's came up, but one of the submarines didn't, so he got the pool skimmer to try and fish the submarine out, and the neighbor came home in the meantime and found, apparently it was a somewhat testy neighbor.
Oh yeah, that always, it was only one neighbor, and that was down just next door.
And found Johnny Mercer and his grandson fishing submarines out of his pool, where they hadn't been asked to be anyway in the first place.
Well, there was always something the matter with, you know, and then finally Ginger did make peace with it. And we put a fence around the property. And now he was a strange man. Nice guy. But Johnny was that way. I mean, he didn't think twice about using somebody else's pool. You know, I mean, they were neighbors, for goodness sake. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's hello, stranger, goodbye, friend. Mm-hmm. He never met anybody in his life that wasn't a friend. And he always said, it doesn't make any difference what a person does. As long as they do it well, you have to respect them. So whether it's shining shoes or writing songs, mm-hmm, that person has their place in life and in history. He was very full. He was like my father a lot. Daddy was the same way. And in that instance, I think maybe the affinity that we had was that I too was adopted. Mm-hmm. And I remember telling, I was going to school at Chadwick, and I told Bebe Daniels, Ben Lyon, that I'd been adopted, and she came back to my father and told him. And he came to me and he said, you know, are you ashamed of us? And I said, no, I told her and Ben this because I was wanted. I knew I was wanted from the very beginning. You came and got me. I didn't come to you. And I think Johnny felt the same way about his two kids, that they were wanted. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to prove to them all the time that they were indeed wanted. So I think that put us closer together, but you could walk down the street and somebody would make a remark to him in passing and he would stop and chat with him. You know, and I remember always people seeing him on the street and then would say, we've got to have lunch. And Johnny would look him square in the eye and say, when? He said, I've had enough of this. We've got to have lunch. He said, I've had one friend of mine say it for 40 years and never got around to it. So he would say, okay, when, and write it down. I remember one time when he went to New York and he packed, I think, a dozen shirts and was still there 6 weeks later, 2 months later. And every day he'd go out to an Aero shirt shop and buy a new shirt. And he'd come home at night, take the one that he had on off, throw it in the closet. And when Ginger arrived at the Plaza Hotel in New York, there were like 3 dozen shirts stacked up, and he never even sent them out for laundry. But that's the way he was. You know. You had to really know him, because there were lots of different sides to Mr. Mercer. But I think his friendship and his love for just anything and everything came through. You know, you must have been a beautiful baby, because baby, look at you now. And it was all true with him. Mm-hmm. You know, it was all part of life. And, anything else?
Oh, yeah, we'll get more. But I can share with you something that somebody told us about this thing about life. Apparently, when they were visiting Savannah one time, I think it must have been Jeff, took a shine to a turtle and brought it back.
Yeah.
And they said that when it came time to return the turtle, that Johnny insisted on flying the turtle back to Georgia.
Yeah.
You were around for that.
That was him. Oh, yeah. Well, you know, when the Depression hit, his father had lost, I don't know, in bonds, and Woody Woodson was his business manager. Mm-hmm. And he went down to Savannah, and Johnny put out word that he would buy anybody that had the bonds, he would pay them off, give them their money back. Mm-hmm. From all these years before. And they were copying them. They were having forgeries done. And people were bringing the things in, and Woody was having one hell of a time taking the original documents from the forgeries because they were done so well. And they came out in an article in Reader's Digest, and Johnny was mad as hell that they'd written this about him. He didn't want anybody to know that he'd done it. That was when I think they sold Capitol Records, and he had a big cash flow. Mm-hmm. Come in, and he said, I'm going to take care of my father's debts, which he wasn't liable for in any way, shape, or form. Mm-hmm. But when the news, when it did come out that he had done it, he was very unhappy about it.
We'd heard that. Yep. We have a lot of mail in this second group of materials that Mrs. Mercer sent us. There was the big packet, and it was mail that had come in response to the Reader's Digest or the Coronet, whatever right. article was that came out. And people from, there's one that's in Spanish, and I think it's from a nun in Spain or Portugal or somewhere, and writing in response and saying, you know, such a wonderful thing you've done, and you've restored our faith.
Yeah, people. But he didn't want, he was very private about that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And didn't want anybody to know. And when it did come out, he was hurt more than anything that they hadn't at least let him know that they were going to do this.
Mm-hmm. Who did it, do you know?
It was Reader's Digest, but it was from, I think, Coronet or whatever magazine it happened to be that had written the thing originally. How they got a hold of the stuff, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's hard to keep something that wonderful a secret, so you have to figure that somebody would know. What kind of people came to the houses? Were you around when they entertained?
Oh yeah.
People around, or?
Well, like I said, the Bushkins mm-hmm. were very close friends. They used to see them in New York. They had Bushkins kept an apartment at River House. She is the niece of T. Netscher. She and her sister, Molly Bragno, I don't know how many millions of dollars, and he had been married to Rosie Dolly of the Dolly sisters. Mm-hmm. And the Bushkins' oldest daughter married Alfred Lowe mm-hmm. of Lerner and Lowe, and used to call him Big Al. She was like 19 and he was 72.
Oh.
I mean, it was or maybe 62, but I mean, it was a vast difference. She was like wife number six. Mm-hmm. But, I never went to Savannah because just at that time, my father had a heart attack. And so Johnny had an architect go out and photograph the house and measure it and do a set of blueprints from the house and send them back to California, and then I rearranged the rooms and sent the furniture down, took windows out, put windows in, took partitions out for walls and stuff. And then my father had an aneurysm, and he was like the sixth or ninth person out of 300 to live through the thing, and he lasted 6 months and then died. But at that point, I couldn't go to Savannah, and so Johnny said, well, I'll have this done, which he did. And it was all done, and it was a very folksy house. I've seen obviously photographs of it. And then when Johnny died, I think Jeff got the house or something, but anyway, I know he took all the furniture up to Medford, Oregon. And there was a lot of early American stuff. Mm-hmm. That people collected in California, at least, dry sinks and that sort of thing, tables. And Ginger had kept the French stuff for the house here in town. But,
did Ginger do a lot of collecting and
yeah.
and that kind of thing?
Well, she liked shopping. I mean, this little laptop desk.
Oh, the one
you mentioned. Yeah, which opens up, and it's a whole writing thing and a secret compartment and everything. She bought when they were doing Good Companions in Alaska, and it had come from Russia, strangely enough, all inlaid in mother of pearl and brass. And she picked up these really strange little things each time, like the two Russian pieces mm-hmm. of the Rams. And strangely enough, when I was in London, they had another pair, and they both had heads at the same end. And I said, didn't they ever make a pair of the opposite? And he said, no, this was a Russian porcelain factory, and they only did one. And if you wanted a pair of them, they both had heads at the same end. You know, it was not one looking at another.
Mm-hmm.
But, no, she did all that stuff. Excuse me.
Sure. Can we take a break?
Yeah, just a second.
Give me a minute. Okay, I think we're back on.
Okay.
You were saying that you go back, you go to the house twice a day?
Yeah, I go out to the house twice a day and see Ginger, and her eyesight was failing. And then Mark died.
Mm-hmm. Mark Kramer.
Kramer died, and...
That must have been very hard.
It was a relief.
Really?
He had alienated everybody. Her sisters, Mandy and Jeffrey.
Mm-hmm.
He tried to do it with me, but it didn't work. Because, I mean, I got there first. I had known her, and I had precedence over anyone and anybody that came afterward.
Mm-hmm.
And I had keys to the house.
Right.
So if I wanted to get in, I'd turn the alarm off and walk in and sit there until they got home. But when Mark finally was dying, and we sat at that funeral, and Ginger had me telling her stories about Johnny and I when we would travel. And I said, we've got to listen to this eulogy. And she said, what eulogy? And I said, we're here. Oh, yeah. And Buddy, who was a good friend of his, Buddy Rogers, Mary Pickford's husband, got up and spoke. And
he was a friend of Mark.
Yeah. Well, he'd known them all for a long, long time.
Mm-hmm.
Ginger, strangely enough, retained one really close friend besides myself. And that was Lee Gershwin, Ira Gershwin's wife,
mm-hmm.
who was a friend, and she always went to the house for New Year's Eve. And then she died.
Ginger went to the Gershwin's house for New Year's Eve.
And then I gave a party always the Friday before Christmas, and I'd have 200-300 people at the house. And Ginger knew all of them. I mean, Lana Turner would be there. Martha Ray, who lived up the street, not on Shalon, but, you know, going up, I can't remember the name of the street. But they all worked together and had known one another. And I think 2 years in a row, Ginger came and she had a white mink coat that she'd had dyed red that she'd only wear at Christmas time. And when I'd come back from the islands, I didn't see an awful lot of them, and I didn't realize that Johnny, well, they didn't know I was here, actually, they didn't. And I stayed at home for 10 years. And then after Johnny died, Ginger and I got back together, and as I said, the last year I took her to Baden-Baden. And we got there, and she said, I never should have come here because all I can think of is being here with Mark.
They used to go.
Yeah. And so we stayed, I think, 11 days instead of 3 weeks and went home. And at that point, she was coming back in the car. She was telling me the same story that she told me on the way out to the airport. And the chauffeur looked at the mirror and sort of said, you know, shrugged. And then after we dropped her at Shalon, he brought me into town. And he said, my God, do you realize? And I said, yeah. And she told me that story every day that we were gone. But she was confused at the end.
And was that like the last year or two of her life?
Yeah. And Lydia and her husband Oswaldo were there
mm-hmm.
and took care of her. And we had a little elevator attached to the stairwell. Or still the arm thing going up, and she would get on it, and she was docile like a child.
Mm-hmm.
And Oswaldo would walk her around so she'd get some exercise, it didn't atrophy. But I'd go out and I didn't know whether I'd been there or not, you know. And I talked to Lydia later and she'd say, oh, she said, Mrs. Mercer said, wasn't it nice that Bobby came out from the house today? So she did know. Mm-hmm. And then she went to the hospital and then Lydia called me and she was gone. And that was that. Mm-hmm. And Ginger had told Lydia to give me all of the stuff, of her personal stuff, to go to the Colleagues, which is a group of ladies that raises money for deaf and blind children. So I took all these marvelous Hermes scarves and, you know, clothing. She had incredible taste in clothing. Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful clothing. And she loved shoes. I did a whole closet just for shoes, and it all swung around. So you had winter shoes and summer shoes.
Uh-huh.
And purses that went with them. She was very meticulous, that lady. Mm-hmm. And she had great style.
And, we've heard that.
Yeah. And Janice Page, who was a very good, I mean, she's as close as a sister could be to it, was also on the board for ASCAP. And she said, Ginger comes in and just talks right through to me. And I said, don't worry. You know, Johnny and she literally were the ones that pushed the whole idea to get it started. So you can put up with this little old lady babbling forever and a day, because thank God, you know, Zippity Doodah, the one song her husband wrote that got an Academy Award or anybody ever heard of, now, name two songs that Ray Gilbert wrote, Zippity Doodah and What? Mm-hmm. And so it was always a tenuous thing. I think I told you on the phone that Johnny had never met Cole Porter, or vice versa. And that Irving Lazar was the agent for both of them. So Irving was having a party, and I said, you ought to have the Mercers, since Johnny and Cole had never met. So Sal Hurock told me, when you introduce them, he said, you can't just say Mr. Mercer, Mr. Porter. He said, may I present Mr. Porter? Mr. Porter, may I present Mr. I said, yeah, I'll do that. So we got to the party, and I said, Cole, may I present Johnny Mercer? Johnny, may I present Cole Porter? And Cole right off the bat said, if there's one song I wish I'd written, it would be Laura. And Johnny looked at him and said, hell man, that would have been a hit if you'd called it Joe. Cole said, you couldn't call it Joe, it's one syllable. He said, so call it Joe-O. And he said, Mr. Mercer, you don't always write the music. He said, I do. But he said, people are always asking me, what's more important, the lyric or the music? And he said, in this instance, it's the lyric. And Johnny turned around, looked at me, and he said, tell him to hum the lyric.
There we go. I think we're back.
All right.
So Mrs. Mercer, kind of after Mr. Mercer died, really only kept close touch with a few people.
With her sisters.
Mm-hmm.
And Mark got into the middle of that on different occasions for what, I don't know. He was so jealous of everybody. I mean, when they would travel, he would book rooms in his name, not hers, and I'd call the Village on the Park in London, and they'd say, no, there was no Mrs. Mercer, and I'd say, well, Mark Kramer, and then she'd pick up the phone. Mm-hmm. And she said, well, he should have put my name on it. I mean, I think she made him part of the foundation. I never did know, and I never did ask, because mm-hmm. that was her business, not mine.
Right. So her sisters and Mark Kramer and you and Lee Gershwin.
Well, yeah, but her two sisters are marvelous.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'd known them off and on, and her mother, who used to come and visit, Johnny adored his mother-in-law. I mean, just adored her. She, Nina could do no wrong when she was there. Marvelous lady. And, I mean, he would just literally stop working and take her all over the place.
Ginger's mother.
Yeah.
I heard she was quite a wonderful
lady. She was
a
great game. But, you know, if you asked him to do something for you, it not only delighted him, but he'd drop anything he was doing and go on. I mean, one time we came back to the Lido house and I said, "What are you doing?" And he said, "I'm writing a song for you, kid." And I said, "What's it called?" And he said, "Something's Gotta Give." And it was for Daddy Long Legs. And we went to the premiere of the thing. And Ray Anthony, who was married to, gee, we'll have to figure out, the wife was a sort of Marilyn Monroe copy for a short time, and lived up on Rising Glen Road, where I did. I had a house at the end of it. And they played the Star Spangled Banner, and Ray tapped Johnny in the back, and Johnny was about three words ahead of everybody in the theater. Was at Mann's, or Grauman's Chinese Theater, it was Mann's, or Mann's now. And he said, "Hey man, get the beat, get the beat." And he said, "Hell, there ain't no beat." And was singing way ahead of everybody else on the Star Spangled Banner. And then he had written a song for Fred Astaire to do, and it was to sort of tie the picture together that Audrey Hepburn, being so much younger than Fred, didn't make any sense. When an irreplaceable, what are the words? I know them so well, because I've done it a thousand times. But it pulled the whole picture together, and it made sense that this older man could fall for this younger girl and not make it seem unseemly or, you know, pedophile. And but something's gotta give, something's gotta give, something's gotta give. So that was always my song. And
somebody had mentioned to us that Hollywood is hard on like spouses of celebrities who die or who are divorced or separated.
The minute they're gone, nobody remembers. It's like my best friend is a man named Terrence O'Flaherty that wrote for the Chronicle. He was the dean of TV critics. And he said, you know, everybody would send me Christmas cards and champagne and stuff. And then when I announced I wasn't going to write the column any longer, I never heard from him again.
Okay, we were talking about Hollywood and spouses. And what happens when the celebrity dies? You said that it's as if the other party didn't exist.
Yeah. And then in Ginger's case, it was so difficult because she had been a child prodigy. And it was, you know, women don't speak up quite as much as I don't know, they should be or should do. And she was always quite firm in her feelings about just anything and everything. And so she had alienated an awful lot of people.
By expressing opinions?
Yeah, but she was totally opposite from Johnny. She was sophisticated. He was a Huckleberry friend. You know, he was a boy from the South in a Panama suit and a straw hat. And she was, you know, had towels in the bathroom instead of paper. That sort of thing, and it was a big difference. I mean, her tastes and everything were far different from Johnny's, and yet he came up and was brought up in a very elegant household, as far as I was told. And Mrs. Mercer, who I met only once, was a grand dame, so to speak, and Walter, his brother. But they were entities that I really didn't know that much of. But when you see somebody on a daily basis for years and years and years and years and years, I mean, it was phenomenal. So you were incorporated into everything that happened. I mean, Debbie, one of Ginger's sisters, would come out, and Debbie would be here, and then, I mean, just was went on and on and on. But they didn't see an awful lot of Amblin. And but they entertained a group of people. They other songwriters, musicians of all sorts, Nat and Maria Cole and Paula Weston. And then they had that 25th wedding anniversary bash, and they took over Romanoff's.
Oh, did they? I hadn't heard about that.
You hadn't?
No, nobody's mentioned it.
Oh, Lord. They had Nelson Riddle and his orchestra. Helen O'Connell got up and sang Tangerine. Then Lisa Kirk got up and sang. Then Judy Garland got up and sang. And I had brought Dolores Gray, who nobody had known in this country. She'd done Annie Get Your Gun in London for 2.5 years. And then she just opened in Two on the Isle with Burt Lahr in New York. And I brought her to the 25th wedding anniversary. And Johnny was sitting with us, and he said, well, now that they've sung, get up and show them how the whole thing's done. And she said, Mr. Mercer, I don't sing for my supper, because she hadn't rehearsed with them. However, we went back to the Luff's house, and strange enough, Lisa Kirk got up and sang The Man That Got Away, which was a song written by Harold Arlen for Judy Garland, and to sing it in her house. Mm-hmm. Was something else, but Dolores did a song that Harold Arlen and I always said was my song on Here's That Rainy Day, which she had introduced in Carnival in Flanders. But that wedding anniversary was probably the most spectacular party I've ever been to. Everybody that was anybody was there, and with his orchestra and the entertainment, I mean, you had $500,000 worth of entertainment just coming from all of these people that loved Johnny and had done his songs. Tangerine, Helen O'Connell, had made her career. And Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe, that Judy sang and got an Academy Award. It was an absolutely spectacular evening. And it was so amazing because I was standing with Dolores when we first got there, and this bimbo came in on the arm of some director, I can't remember who it was, and she said, is this special occasion or something? And Dolores said, yes, they've been married 25 years. The girl says, oh. Turns back to her and says, well, God, I've been married 25 years. And she said, yes, but this is to the same person. She said, oh. Oh, well, I didn't know that. She said, actually, I've been married 32 years, but I've had 4 husbands. Said, that doesn't count. You don't hit 25 years of being married to everybody and say, I just won the Academy Award. But, oh, there were so many stories I could tell you. We were in New York one time, and had come out of Sardi's, Ginger, Johnny, and myself, and we're walking down the street, and up pulls a taxi, and out jumps Bobby Short. And Bobby Short had on a pork pie hat, a button-down collared shirt, a knit black tie, a suit from Brooks Brothers, and penny loafers on with white socks. And he hugged all of us and kissed Ginger on the cheek, and Johnny, myself, gave us a hug. And there was, you know, yak, but nothing, the weather, whatever it was. And he walked in, and Johnny turned around and looked at me and said, man, how white can you get? I mean, it was funny. And then, maybe I'll shut that off, I'll tell you a story that I don't know whether you want to hear or not, or want a tape on.
Okay, well, hold on a minute.
Yeah.
Do Okay, we're back on.
Yeah. But no, yeah, I don't think that.
It's up to you whether you want to tell it
or not. No, but it was just that he had a witty something or other for just about anybody, but he was never hurtful. Mm-hmm. You know, there are two ways of doing it. You can either be downright disgusting and hurtful, mm-hmm. or you can be flip about it and still make your point. Right. And I think Johnny did that in the long run. I know one time we went down to a progressive party, and anyway, these people had leased a bus with mariachis on the back end of the things and giving out margaritas. And they drove the bus down to Capistrano for a Mexican restaurant mm-hmm. called the Willows or something like that. And Ginger said, I'm going to take out my compact and pretend I've never seen the son of a bitch before in my life. And at that point, Johnny from the other end of the room said, hey, Bobby, who are these no-talent people? And I said to Ginger, get a cab. So off we went. Mm-hmm. But he would take so much of it, and when he would realize, oh, it's like Daddy used to say, God gives you your relatives, thank God you can make your own friends. Mm-hmm. And that was it. When relatives were around, didn't make any difference what they said. It was no problem. But when it came to friends, he was not a bumpkin. And a lot of people thought that he could be. He was a highly intelligent, sensitive human being. And he would take so much of it and then just realize that they didn't know what they were talking about. And it was just, he always had something sensitive to say, something incisive, something that just made you feel good. Mm-hmm. Never gave advice. He'd give for instances. This could happen or that could happen. And, you know, take your pick. But, and always interested in people he didn't know. How were my mother and father? How was my sister? What were they doing? How was Daddy getting along? And one time he even sent flowers to Mama, and she called him up and said, Mr. Mercer, we grow our own flowers, and I don't know why you're sending them. He said, well, weren't you there last night? And she said, where? Because he'd done one of his little torments. Mm-hmm. And but my parents never met him. And he would call Daddy and say, can Bobby stay overnight? Because we're going to go to a movie and it'll be late and I don't want him driving home, you know, that late at night. And we climb in the car and go to a party in Los Angeles. But it was some experience.
You said there was something that if Mandy hadn't told me that you wanted me to...
But... okay. And Margaret Whiting I would see off and on, and she finally got to, well, I'll tell you, she finally got to Ginger before she died and somehow got involved with the foundation, I don't know how, and then incorporated her husband, Jack Wagner, who used to say he was Dolores Gray's illegitimate child until I told him he'd better stop doing it. And he wrote a book and said he'd made a male porno movie on Fire Island called The Boys in the Sand. And Margaret took up with him for what reason, I don't know. I guess she loves him. And he started writing on the book and said, I for years told people I was Dolores Gray's illegitimate son, and I'm not. I was from Wisconsin or Michigan or someplace. Like that, but it all got very confusing, and I don't know what Margaret's doing with the foundation, but I mean, her father and Johnny did Hooray for Hollywood and knew each other and cared about each other for, you know, as long time, lifetime friends. But I just don't know what she has to do with it, because the kids don't understand how it was. But Ginger was in a vulnerable part of her life, and you could talk her into doing almost anything. She really didn't know what she was doing. But on that, I really don't know. Anything else?
Just one last question. Did you have any connection with the Palm Springs house?
Oh, yeah. I did that whole thing.
We've been trying to figure out how many, we sort of know now how many houses they have.
Oh, yeah.
This all started coming together for us.
Oh, the Palm Springs house was great. It was one of the first houses. We used to go down there. There'd be the Hopes, the Crosbys, Ethel Barrymore and her son, Sammy Colt, the Bushkins. There wasn't really any place to go. The Racquet Club was about it, and a bowling alley, and a hardware store, gas station. And they had these houses, and they were just, well, this one that Johnny and Ginger had was a great house. We'd redo it every couple of years. She had a marvelous Tamayo painting down there of watermelon. I don't know what happened to that. But we did the Palm Springs house, and I used to go down and stay, and strange enough, Chuck Pollock, who called me earlier today, went down with me one day to deliver some headboards and some bedspreads that matched for the guest bedroom. And that was a great house. And then marvelous pool, and they added a tennis court. And
did the pool have a sort of a half wall like around it?
Or yeah.
Did some, I've got these photographs that look
odd. Oh, I've got pictures
odd.
I've got pictures of my dog Dudley, the pug. Mm-hmm. I've got pictures of him down at Palm Springs.
So this was like an enclosure around the pool, kind of for.
The contour of the land went up.
Okay.
And so that they did, they
just enclosed part of it.
Enclosed part of it. Yeah, I got pictures of it upstairs.
Well, the first couple photographs that we saw, I thought, oh, they were building something.
No.
They hadn't put the top on, but I realized this was.
No,
attended.
It was just a retaining wall.
Okay.
But that was a great house. That was a lot of fun house, because that's where a lot of progressive dinners would take place, because there wasn't really any place to go except the Racquet Club. So you'd have soup at one house and cocktails, and then you'd have an entree and more drinks, and then you'd have more drinks and salad, and you'd have more drinks and dessert, and then you'd have drinks and dance and climb in the car and drive a half a mile or a mile, whatever it was, from any of the houses, because they were all right there together.
Mm-hmm.
And, and that was such fun, such a lot of fun. And then just to go shopping with them was a joy.
What kind of places did Mrs. Mercer favor for shopping?
She loved Bullocks Wilshire and I Magnins, and we were in Bullocks Wilshire one time. And we were walking into the fur department, and she skidded on the floor, slipped and fell, and hit her coccyx, the back tailbone. And we picked her up, and Johnny said to her, "Are you hurt?" And she said, "Only my pride," because she'd taken a pratfall in front of all these people. "Only my pride." But you know, so many of Johnny's songs were done that way, because one time Ginger had been all gung-ho for going to New York, and then suddenly she said, "Oh, I don't know, the weather and the whole thing, we might as well stay here." And Johnny said, "Well, why, you know, you get me all excited about going," and then she, and Ginger looked at him and said, "It's a woman's prerogative to change your mind." Mm-hmm. Well, you probably heard "I'm Gonna Love You" when Irving Lazar came to the opening of St. Louis Woman. And Harold and Johnny asked him what he thought of the show. And he said, "There's no tune that you can take out of the show that can become a hit." So Johnny said, "Well, I know what we're gonna do. We're gonna write a song and it's gonna be called 'I'm Gonna Love You Like Nobody's Loved You,' and Harold said, 'Come Hell or High Water.'" And Johnny said, no, come rain or come shine. But I mean, it was funny how these songs, but I remember it's a woman's prerogative to change your mind. And Johnny said, ah, there we go.
It's one of my favorite songs.
Yeah, well, it's a great song, you know. But as I said to you, I think on the phone, not since Stephen Foster has there been an American songwriter who captures America in all its facets, you know, from its immigrants to Mexicans coming across the border to just plain ordinary folk. And Johnny did that in so many of his songs. And then Barry Manilow took that one, When October Comes or Goes, which he did. Ginger gave him some of Johnny's lyrics that he'd never had music put to, that are still incredibly brilliant. But he is the first American songwriter with an essence of what this country is all about. And when you consider Moon River, the most played song in the world, I mean, it's incredible. This is 20 years after it.
It still won awards for the most played or the most used, most sung or different.
But when Ginger accepted an award for Johnny from the Grammys, and they had finally given one to Billie Holiday, and the little girl backstage who didn't know nothing said to Ginger, it must be wonderful to receive a Grammy for your husband. And she turned to me and said, how many is this? And I said, I think this is number 19. Isn't that about it?
We don't know on the Grammys. We haven't looked it up.
I think there's 27 actually. Mm-hmm. But I think 19 of them I knew about.
We knew there were 18 nominations for Best Song for Academy Awards.
Yeah.
And four winners, but we haven't traced the genealogy of the Grammys yet.
But, and now with the advent of Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, his music is even bigger and better.
Have you seen the picture?
No, I've not seen it. I read the book.
It's great. It's right in front of
him. Yeah. John Barrett called me and asked me if I'd come back and speak at the Alice Tully Hall, and I said no. I mean, what I remember and have to say isn't much news. It's just that this was a period of my life, well, the biggest part of my life, really, taken up with a true American genius, no doubt about it, who touches people in probably the most vulnerable way, and that's through music. Everybody associates a birth or a death or a romance with a song. And so many of those songs are Johnny Mercer, and most people don't know it. I walked into Capitol Records with a Johnny singing the Mercer songbook, and the little girl, secretary to the president of the company, which was bought from Mr. Mercer and Wallach. It was an English firm. And she said, who's Johnny Mercer? And I said, you're sitting in a building that he was responsible for. She had no idea who he was. And she said, oh, you mean Henry Mancini? I said, no. Henry Mancini wrote the music. But you can hear the lyric as a poem and will say, yes, that's Moon River, or that's the Days of Wine and Roses. And know what it was without the music. You know, Raskin had written Laura, and the picture had been out almost a year before they came to Johnny and asked him to put words to it. So it was a whole different bag. And so many of his things, Autumn Leaves was a French song called La Femme Morte. It had been a great success in Europe. And when he did the words to it, Autumn Leaves, he said, that song is popular already, and it'll become more popular probably with English words. But he said, I don't take credit for that song in any way, shape, or form. And I think all of the profits from that particular song go to French orphans. Or it's Deaf or Blind. I don't know what it is exactly. Ginger Tone one time. Same thing was with I Want to Be Around, and the woman sent him the idea, and he said, since your idea, you get half of the profit. Mm-hmm. And she became an instant celebrity overnight. But there was something else. Let me turn the thing off and let me show you those pictures. Strange enough, I took my dog out.
Okay, we're back on. You said they cut the DeLongpre house in half?
Well, the house was right here, the next block. Mm-hmm. And what happened was the freeway was supposed to go through here to the Pacific Coast Highway. Mm-hmm. So you could go from Santa Ana to the Pacific Coast Highway and then go up to Santa Barbara and on to San Francisco. And then it was also supposed to connect with the one that goes to Sacramento, mm-hmm. no, the 105 or 405, whatever it is. So in preparation for that, Billy Wilder and Audrey and Johnny and Ginger sold their houses, which were here, and moved. Well, they never did the freeway. So they're now apartment houses.
Mm-hmm. I looked right to see here. If I could see it.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, since I was here.
There's nothing. Yeah, no, there's nothing left. And this was a really sort of middle Los Angeles. You were next to Beverly Hills. Mm-hmm. You were not Hollywood, mm-hmm. but you were West Hollywood. And it was a very convenient thing. So at that point, they bought the house on Lido Island mm-hmm. and moved down there. And Johnny was commuting, which is insane.
Well, Mandy said the kids liked it. It was part of the reason.
Well, it was mostly for the kids and then to get them out of the school district here. Mm-hmm. But I never saw that house. I just heard about it and how they saw it and happened. Took it down in the dead of night when there was no traffic to Long Beach at 10 miles an hour or 5 miles an hour, whatever you can pull a house at.
And gave it to your secretary.
Couldn't have been much faster than that.
Not much.
But they lived right here. Mm-hmm. And Boyd Willett, who still has a house across the street in Junior City, was the only kid in the neighborhood. And he was always, she'd see his butt hanging out of a garbage can. He'd go through all their garbage to see if he could find anything. And Boyd's now in his 50 uh-huh. years of age. But I mean, at Mandy's, I think Mandy got older and I got younger. Because I'm still, I don't know, 15 years older than she is, but we're closer of an age. Mm-hmm. You know, 50 and 70 doesn't seem too far apart.
Yeah. But once you get to about 35, it really doesn't matter.
Yeah, 15 and 30, it's really a big difference.
Right.
But now she's... Mandy did a complete 100 around turn. Mm-hmm. She'd sit and stick her tongue out at me and blow smoke in my face. And I'd say, you're not supposed to be smoking, you little brat. And she did.
This was when she was what?
In her teens. And then she ran away from home and spent one night out. And my God, you would have thought that she'd been captured by white slavery. Uh-huh. Johnny went crazy, so did Ginger. She was in the neighbors. Mm-hmm. You know, it was no big thing. She was just rebelling. They sent her to Chadwick. Mm-hmm. Where I went and got kicked out as one of 14 kids that smoked. Used to blow the smoke into the wash rag so they couldn't smell it. Mm-hmm. And my roommate, who was a really belligerent little kid, took a blowtorch and heated the doorknob on our door, mm-hmm. slammed it and let out a yell, and the house father came running down the hall, grabbed the thing, and he ran around with his hand in a thing with the fingers wired apart so they wouldn't grow together.
Yeah.
Because he burned his whole hand. But the kid said, you're never going to hit me again, are you? He didn't get slapped once.
No, I would think that.
But we also got kicked out.
Mandy got to stay, right?
Well, Mandy, this was years later. Mm-hmm. It was years after I was booted. But I guess then the other thing was that we were about the only kids whose parents weren't divorced. You know, they put them in Chadwick because they got rid of them. Mm-hmm. Got them home every 6 weeks. That's it.
I think we're going to lose the tape. We're right okay. about now.
Well, that's it. I mean, I don't have really much more to say, except that I just want to do your little spiel.
Okay, we're back on again. And you were saying in closing you wanted to highlight...
That I just wanted to say that it was not only a privilege, but he has shaped my life and in turn shaped people's lives that know me. Mm-hmm. Because from the experience that I had with this gentleman, it was one of humility. Mm-hmm. Don't underestimate yourself. But all people are created equal. I mean, when Mandy got married, she was married at the Bel Air Country Club because they wouldn't allow black people into the hotel. Mm-hmm. And we had everybody under the sun. Or we had, I mean, I'm beginning to sound like a stage mother. But they had. And it was so funny because Ginger, she grabbed her diamond necklace and she said, put it on me, and I put it on backwards. So when they had the pictures come out, here was this necklace upside down. All the diamonds were against her skin and all you saw was the platinum fretwork. And then she put on one white pearl and one black pearl earring, and it created a whole new style just because she had done it. And suddenly people wanted one black and one white pearl, you know, and the diamond. But he was a great influence, and inadvertently a great influence for me to follow, a great example. I think I probably get mean when I drink. I don't remember an awful lot of that, but I've been told. But it was such a pleasure, you know? Mm-hmm. And people come up to me and say, did you know him? Yeah, I knew him. I knew him, I loved him. I looked forward to each day just being in his presence, just being around him. And there were lots of good days and there were just as many bad days. But it all blended together somehow. And as I said, it was awesome to be with somebody that had a mind. I mean, you could give him a quip and he'd make a song up about it. It was the easiest thing in the world. It just came to him. You know, he had that gift. And she was about as loving a person as you could get. And she never knew what impact she had on her husband, I don't think. She really didn't know how much he loved her. But as the doctor said, this old man who was retired came to the hospital. He'd been with my mother my father when he had died, or he'd come out of retirement. His son had taken over the practice. And he came down to the hospital and Mama died, and that was the day that we were supposed to move into the Bel Air house. And the Bushkins were there and they had a picnic and the furniture arrived and everything. And same thing applied with Johnny and Ginger. And this man came to me and he said, I don't know how many eyes I've opened and how many eyes I've closed, how many people I've given birth to, how many people that have died. And he said, I don't know if there's a God or not. But he said, I will tell you one thing. Today, your mother and father are having lunch together. That's all there is to it. And the same thing with Johnny and Ginger. Mm-hmm. She missed him so.
Yes.
Really missed him, because it was, they would argue and argue and argue. I one time picked him up and took him to the train with Ginger. Drove in from Lido. And they argued all the way. And finally, he climbed on the train and said, don't want to come on and have a drink with me? And Ginger said, no, we got to get back. And he said, well, give me a kiss. So she turned her cheek to him. And he kissed her on the cheek. The guy gave him a hug and a kiss. And he climbed on the train and we waved as he went. And I turned around, Ginger's standing in back of me, and she's crying. I said, I don't believe you. I mean, here you are arguing with him all the way into town, and I turned around and you're crying. And she said, you want to know something? Tomorrow I'm going to miss him. Well, that's the way it was. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, you didn't have to say it. You knew it. I mean, I wouldn't see Johnny for, if he'd be in the East or I'd be in Europe, I wouldn't see him for a couple of months, and I'd come back. And we'd start talking as if we had just left off a sentence 2 minutes before. Mm-hmm. And we just filled in the gaps of what had happened in the interim. But I knew him like a book. I could tell what mood he was in, what he wanted to do, what he liked to do, and it was just a delight. He was my star performer of all time. Daddy once called him, and when he was doing the Camel show, the radio thing, and he said, Mr. Mercer, do they pay you for singing? Johnny said, yeah, a lot of money. Daddy said, well, if I retire, I know what I can do. Because, I mean, if you can get away with it with that voice, I've got a fighting chance. And Johnny said, your father must be quite a guy. And I said, yeah, he certainly is. But, you know, when you hear him sing his songs, people have listened to that record, that tape that I brought from London, time after time, and they said, I didn't know he was a singer. Or they'll come back after I've had tapes made and I've sent them to Mandy and stuff. And they'll listen to it and they'll say, who's singing? And I said, Johnny Mercer. He's singing? I thought it was Sinatra. I thought it was Matt Monroe. I thought it was, you know. But it's Johnny.
Mm-hmm. What recording is it?
It's the Johnny Mercer. You never heard it?
I'm not sure which one. Is it the Pye Records recording?
No, I don't think you have. It's his master's voice. I'll go downstairs.
I'd have to see. Because we have a lot, but we...
I'll go downstairs and get it. I don't think you have it. Let me just run downstairs and I'll get it.
Okay.